Got your Bibles, turn to Psalm 86. I'm going to get back to Daniel after our Jubilee. I'm in Jubilee mode. That means I'm at it. I want to get something from God. How about you? I found out something about our Jubilees. They don't go without opposition.
Amen, preacher.
You hear me? I mean, I get it from all sides. But I want to tell you, I got a thrice holy God who wants me to pray, who wants me to approach him, that wants to bless me and bless this church. And I believe he'll help you tonight. I hope you got your Bible with you. And I want you to follow me. I got some things for you. You know, I think a lot of times we don't get something from God because we don't know how to approach God. Somebody help me. By the way, the best way to approach God is open your Bible and have a Bible in your hand. And you ain't got beyond listening to the preacher. And if you've got beyond preaching, listen to the preacher and bringing your Bible to church, something wrong with you. You a sick puppet. Somebody help me. We need the Word of God. Need to find what God has in the Word. Psalm 86. Are you there? Say amen. I'm gonna read just a portion of it. Then I'm gonna take you over to Luke just for a moment and show you two things real quickly. You can hold your hand two places, Luke chapter number 11 and Luke chapter number 18. And I'm trying to help you approach God. A lot of folks ask me, say, preacher, I don't understand why I'm not getting my prayers answered. I don't understand why God's not moving for me. I see him moving for everybody else. I see God working everybody else's life. Why isn't he working my life? Could it be that you don't even know how to approach God? Look what David said in Psalm 86, and we'll jump over in just a moment. He said, bow down thine ear, O Lord. Hear me. For I am poor and needy. Preserve my soul, for I am holy. O Lord my God, save thy servant that trusteth in thee. Be merciful unto me, O Lord, for I cry unto thee daily. Rejoice the soul of thy servant from under thee, O Lord. Do I lift up my soul? For thou, Lord, art good. Somebody help me there. And ready to forgive, and plenteous in mercy unto all them which call upon his name. Give ear, O Lord, unto my prayer. Attend to the voice of my supplications in the day of my trouble. In the day of my trouble, I will call upon thee, for thou wilt answer me. We're needy people.
Amen.
I don't know about you, but you say, Preacher Smith, you're a pastor. You've been doing this for 46 years. You ain't got no trouble. I want to tell you, we all got trouble. I'm preaching tonight on how to approach God in the times of need. We're needy people. We'll give you something, but I want you to turn back to Luke first and just follow me, stay with me, and I hope I can get all these truths out to you real quickly. Turn to Luke chapter number 11. If you're there, say amen. Luke chapter 11. Bible said it came to pass that as he was praying in a certain place, when he ceased, one of his disciples said unto him, Lord, teach me to pray. Did you notice he didn't say, Lord, teach me to preach? He didn't say, Lord, teach me to tithe? He didn't say, Lord, teach me to be a better Christian? He said, teach me to pray. And he said unto him, and he gives him, and by the way, I do not want you to look at this verse and these verses and call this the Lord's Prayer. It is not the Lord's Prayer. This is the model prayer. If you want to know where the Lord's Prayer is, it's in John chapter 17. This is the model prayer on how you should pray. But now notice down in verse number 5. I want you to see something. He illustrates this, Chad, and it shows how you ought to approach God. And when he said unto him, which of you having a friend, and shall go unto him at midnight and say unto him, friend, lend me 3 loaves. For a friend of mine in his journey has come to me, and I have nothing to set before him. And he from within shall answer and say, trouble me not. The door is now shut, and my children are in the bed. I cannot rise and give thee. And I say unto you, though he will not rise and give him, because he is his friend, yet because, listen to this word that we don't use, importunity, he will arise and give him as many as he needs. How many of y'all know what that little word importunity means? You know what it means, Chad? You're going to learn tonight. You're going to learn tonight. That little word means shameless persistence. What that word means is, I'm not going to take no for an answer. I'm not going to quit praying. How many of you are guilty of this? You pray for a little while, you get frustrated, you get tired, you get weary, and you stop. And some of you have stopped just before your miracle came. Some of you, the devil stopped just before God had a rescue. Somebody help me preach right there. I see so many people, you know what their problem is? They want it now. They want it now. They want everything now. They don't want no delay. They don't want to have to be persistent. They don't. Hey, this man, when he went to his friend, he had shameless persistency. He wasn't ashamed. He said, I'm not going to, he didn't even care. It was midnight. You know something tonight? Some of you got midnight in your soul tonight. Some of you got some crises in your life tonight. Some of you are right at the brink tonight, and you're frightened to go at midnight and knock on the door. But I'll say to you, knock and it shall be open. Seek and you shall find. Somebody help me preach. You know why we don't get our prayers? We don't approach God right. We don't approach him persistently. How many of you ever read the scripture, pray without ceasing? Now stay, jump over to chapter 18 minutes. I'm going to show you the same principle. Turn over to chapter 18. Once you see this, we're approaching God here. Are you there? Say amen. And he spake a parable unto them to this end, that men ought to always what? And listen to this phrase. And not to what? Now write this down in your notes. You know what the word faint means there? It means lose heart. I'm sad to say this, but I preach to a lot of people that have lost heart. They fainted. Right when they was on the verge to get the glory, they lost heart. Here's what happens to you. You think God's unclosed these ears, and you think God's, hey, by the way, God don't always, he doesn't always answer immediately. He always answers. He answers yes, no, and sometimes wait a while. But see, then he illustrates in this chapter, go right on down here. If you look in chapter 18, I don't even know if I'm going to get to my text. You go in chapter 18, talks about a little widow that went to a judge to try to get her to relieve her debt. You see it there? He was an unjust judge, but she kept knocking on his door. Now, I'm talking about an unjust judge. How many of you can raise your hand and know that my God and your God's not an unjust God? He's not an unjust God. But you know what that judge said? She got on Achim. She got him so weary. He said, I'm going to give you. I will take care of it. You want some of you need to do? You need to cry out to God. You need to scream to God. You need to go to God. And I want you to know something. He's going to get some attention. You know what your problem is? You quit too quick. I know folks are not even in church tonight because they got discouraged and didn't do what you preached tonight. We're kind of going together. They didn't encourage themselves. Hey, by the way, you said it right. You need to encourage yourself. Then you inquire of God. You need to be desperate with God. You know what's wrong with this generation? We got fast food mentality. It's the truth. If we can't drive into fast food and get our little McDonald's sandwich in 5 minutes, we mad. I want you to know something. Getting something great from God, it takes fervent prayer. It takes earnest prayer. It takes you getting on your knees and crying out to God. Now I want you to go back to Psalm 86, and I'll give you four things and I'll be done. Four principles. How many of y'all agree with me that God's not a respecter of persons, he's a respecter of principles? You know what I think the problem is today? There's a lot of people today want something from God, but they don't want to get it God's way. Now I'm going to give you five things. Simple. This ain't deep, but it's pretty practical. How many Bible says under Psalm 86, a prayer of David? How many Bibles got that in yours? Follow me. Number one, you want to, Tyler, you want something from God? Here's how you got to approach him. Look at verse one. Bow down thine ear, O Lord. Hear me, for I am poor and needy. Number one, you need to plead. You need to plead to him about your need. I am poor and needy. You know what you need to say to God? I need you. Let me tell you what I see in our churches today, and it scares me to death. We've learned how to be religious. We've learned how to do church. We think we can fix our own problems. But I'll tell you what, you'll never get anything from God until you realize you're poor and needy. I've been doing what I've been doing for 46 years, Kim, and I still never enter this pulpit without it being bathed with prayer because I'm poor and needy. I need God. You said, Preacher Smith, I get my answers in other places. You may, but I need God. I need him to help me. And I know I'm poor and needy. I know I don't have that much ability. I know I can't do it myself. That's the attitude you need to have tonight if you'll ever be able to approach God. You know what happened? How many's ever heard of the Laodicean church of the last days? What did it say about them? What did it say? And what else did it say?
They left their first love.
And they left their first love. What else did it say?
Other things.
I was trying to get you to help me preach. You're doing all right. Turn over. No, don't turn there. Just let me read this to you. Over in Revelation chapter 3. I just want to read this to you. Because thou sayest, I am rich and increased with goods and have need of nothing, and knowest not thou that thou art wretched and miserable and poor and blind and naked.
Amen.
That's our age today. We don't think we need anything. We got the humanists and the liberals and the skeptics saying, oh, you're a weakling if you call on God. Guilty. Guilty.
Amen, preacher.
Guilty. Jesse, the body Ventura, you heard of that wrestler who was an idiot senator from Minnesota. You know what he said about you? That you're weak. And he wrote a whole story about weak Christians and using God for a crutch. I want you to know something. He's more than a crutch to me. He's a wheelchair. He's a hospital bed. He's everything I need. I want Jesse the Body Ventura to know that I ain't nothing, that I've never been nothing, and I'll never be anything without Almighty God. I'm poor, and I'm needy. And if you want to get something from God, get off your high horse. Get your pride out of the way. Get on an altar somewhere and say, God, I need you. Somebody help me. Number two. And by the way, you said, what needs will he meet? He'll meet your spiritual needs. And by the way, every problem you have is spiritual.
Amen.
That's what it starts with. And then it becomes emotional and a lot of times physical. But my God shall supply all your need. But look at secondly, look at verse 2. Preserve my soul. You want to approach God? For I'm holy. Oh Lord my God, save thy servant that trusteth in thee. Whew. You want to have a breakthrough? Some trust in horses. Some trust in chariots. But I done made my mind up. I want to trust in the name of the Lord. For the name of the Lord is a high tower. I'll tell you what you'll do one of these days. You're going to hit bottom. And you ain't going to have anywhere to turn. And I want you to know the preacher ain't sufficient enough to help you. And the deacon ain't sufficient enough to help you. But I want you to know you got a thrice holy God that will help you. I want you to know, I've never seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed begging bread. I got a God that said, if you trust me, I will help you. You know what the Bible said? Though he slay me, though I go through all kind of trouble, though he slay me, yet will I trust him. You say, what do you mean, preacher? You've never been slayed? Sure have. I've been so far down, I've been so low that snakes couldn't even get lower than I was. You said, what did you do when you was in that kind of predicament? Only thing I could do, reach up to God. I approached him. I said, God, I got this right, God. I know you're the only one who can take care of this. I know you're the only one can restore me. I know you're the only one can heal me. I know you're the only one can give me a job. I know you're the only one can touch my physical needs. I know you're the only one. I know you are. I trust you. And look at verse 5, number 3. I'm trying to get all this to you. Whew. How you approach God, number 3. Look at verse 5. Will any of y'all help me read this? Get your Bible and read it with me. Will you? For thou, Lord, say it, are good and ready to what? And plenteous in what? Unto what? All them to call upon his name or call upon thee. See, here's what you need to do. You need to proclaim God is good. Now, I'm going to make a statement here. Can I slow down? God's good all the time. I want all y'all to know something. He's good even when bad things are happening to me. See, here's what has happened in our Christian walk. We equate his goodness with how well we're doing. Well, all you got to do is get a hospital, just get called from the hospital, get called from the doctor. I had one of them this week. It wasn't everything I wanted to hear. It wasn't. I'd like to have just a little better report. It wasn't. But I want to tell you what I did at my office. I got down on my knees and I told him, I said, no matter what happens to me in my life, the rest of my life, you're good. And your mercy endures forever. See, here's what the problem is. Once we have adversity sometimes, we start wondering if he's good. And I want every one of you to know every good gift cometh from the Father above. He's good. With this world, Roger, as wicked as it is, he's good. You said, Preacher Smith, what if I'm having problems? He's still good. And he's still one you can count on. Somebody help me preach. See, I can't get this in your mind. Here's what he wants to do to you, Amy. You know what he wants to do? I just use you as an example. He wants you to have enough, the devil wants you to have enough trouble and enough heartache that you start questioning God's goodness. Huh? You know what I'm talking about? We do it. Hey, the devil wants us to question God. I want every one of you to look at me. God's good. Where would I be without him? He said, but preacher, I've had some setbacks. He's still good. Preacher, everything ain't went quite the way I planned it. He's still good. And he forgives. And he has mercy. And he's a God of second chances. He's a God of third chances. And he will not throw the clay away. He will not give up on you. Just do what Dave said tonight. Encourage yourself in him. Let me give you two more. I'm done. Woo! I just want to give you something practical. I need God. The next 6 weeks as we face Jubilee and we face everything, I need God. Yeah. Number four. Boy, here it is. Y'all there? Look at verse 7. In the day of my trouble, I will call upon you, thee, for thou wilt answer me. Here's what you need to do. Put your confidence in him. You know why we don't pray much? Because we don't believe he's going to answer. Can I ask this church something? I want to ask everybody in here that God has answered a prayer in the last 6 months. Amen. You can approach him. You can have confidence in him. Because he said he will answer. I have been, over the last 46 years, I can name Rich 8 times when I was a young preacher here. When my back was against the wall. You said, what'd you do? I didn't call some priest. I didn't even call some preacher. Because there's some of them I couldn't trust. But I want you to know something. As hard as it's been sometimes in my life, I've never lost confidence in him. I've lost confidence in people. I'm human as you are. You know what your problem is? You don't believe he can answer you. And if you get to that place in your life, you're done. Have confidence in him. He's got your hand. He got your life in his hand. He got the whole world in his hand. He knows my problems. He knows everything. In a time of trouble. You say, well, I ain't got no trouble right now. Here's what I want you to do. Because you're either going in or coming out or getting ready to go back. Because trouble follows you. Job said, my days are few and full of what? You want to approach God? Put your confidence in him. Lastly, look at verse 12 and I'm done. Boy, this is the hardest one, but I think it's one of the greatest ones. Praise God with all your heart. Look at verse 12. I will praise thee, O Lord my God, with all my heart. And I will glorify thy name forever. You want to know how to approach God? I'm done. Y'all all want to know? Joe, we want to know. And I'll tell you what it is, Joe. When we get to the point where all glory is his.
That's right. He's worthy.
All glory. I mean all glory. I'm going to praise him. Yeah. You know what, Rich? I've praised myself out of a lot of problems. Because I just said, Lord, I don't know how you're going to get glory out of this, but I believe you will. How many's that? Come on, let's have a confession time right now. How many's ever had something happen in your life that you thought there ain't no way they can bring glory to God? Sure you have. But you want God to? He brought you through it. And guess what? Who gets the glory? I ain't getting the glory because I didn't do it. Martha, I know you've been hurting. Just give him glory. Give him praise. Because he is good. He's going to take care of this little widow. He's going to take care of our widows. He's going to take care of our widows. He's going to take care of the hurting people. We got a lot of hurt people in this church. Probably more right now, Rich, than I've seen in a long time in our church. They're hurting. And I tell you, they don't need to have a negative message. They need a positive message that God is still on the throne. That God is able. You can put your confidence in him.
Amen.
Now here's what I want to ask you, and I'm done. Is there anybody in this room you're beat down tonight? You felt like quitting. You're just discouraged. Dave's lesson touched you. You're just discouraged. I wonder how many of you just come around this altar and say, you know what? I'm going to follow them five little principles. And I want to approach God right. I need a miracle. Stand with me. Father, have our folks come and pray and pour their heart out to you. God, I thank you for this little tiny lesson from your word. I'll give it all ahead, Lord, but it ain't me, it's you. In Jesus' name, folks are up here praying, come on. I slip out, help us girls, slip out. If I was you, don't get tired of praying. You got a child wayward. You got a need. You need a miracle. Approach him tonight. Come boldly to the throne of grace and mercy.
Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God.
Church, Dave, Thank you for that message. I could have come to church a little discouraged tonight. But you know what? I did one day. I don't know why. I didn't know you were going to read that, but I read that verse before I came, that David encouraged himself. Boy, I feel like God's blessed us. Folks are praying right here at the altar. You know, God loves you. I want to tell all of you, get in. Join this church. Get in. You can be used of God. Get in. So God can use you. Amen.